Hi, I'm Jessica Russo Scherr, and I'm an IB visual arts teacher. This video is intended to help you really get the most out of your IB visual arts class and still meet all of the assessment criteria. Now, rather than putting one of my students on the spot, could I possibly make one artwork that met the requirements for the exhibition, process portfolio, and comparative study? Now, obviously, you have to create more than one artwork for IB Visual Arts. I also hope that you just understand the assessment criteria for IB Visual Arts a little bit better through this video. The bulk of this video will be showing how I created an artwork for IB Visual Arts for the exhibition. And then at the end of the video, I will be breaking it down to see how I can take my preliminary sketches, my research, and all of the process and experimentation work that I did to create this artwork and apply it to the process portfolio, as well as all of the research and ideas behind the techniques and the subject matter and how I could apply that to the comparative study. So make sure you stay tuned till the end of the video. Now, keep in mind, this is going to be a very in-depth way of doing one artwork that addresses all criteria, and this couldn't work for all of your exhibition works. But you should choose this method for when you have a really big project that you want to do. I will be demonstrating with an oil painting and a subject matter that I am interested in. Of course, you need to choose what materials and media you want to use and the subject matter you are interested in. However, it should be linked to art history in order to check all the boxes for an IBHL comparative study and your process portfolio. Even if you haven't officially started your comparative study, it's important to choose one artist that you know that you are going to focus your comparative study on. This will give your art historical foundation for your comparative study, your process portfolio, and your exhibition work. For my example, I chose the Italian artist Artemisia Gentileschi. If you're struggling to find an artist, I suggest looking at museums that you have gone to, books, and Google Arts and Culture. Once you found that work that really grabs your attention, you're going to grab it and don't actually steal it, but move on to your process portfolio, which will be done primarily in your visual arts journal, your sketchbook. This is where you're developing the ideas behind what your composition will look like, the intentions you want, and how the art historical reference will influence it. Now, for my case, I am doing an art historical portrait, so it's kind of easy to tie in those art historical references and the techniques that Artemisia Gentileschi used, but I want to do it in a sort of new and creative way. And that's super important for the process portfolio to identify your intentions and how they personally relate to your development as an artist. That will also come into play for the criteria for the comparative study. So think about how the techniques and skills and ideas relate to your development as an artist as you're starting off in this early process. So for my work, I am choosing three of her paintings, and I'm going to combine them into one scene and pay homage to her as an icon. And I wanted to do this in a way that also addressed the techniques that she used and the way that she has influenced my work. The three works I'm choosing are Judith Slaying Holofernes, Susanna and the Elders, and of course, her self-portrait as an allegory of painting. And I'm going to combine them in a realistic space. So I played around digitally with the images to kind of get a rough idea of how I wanted to have them arranged and what I would have to invent on my own. And I basically took those ideas and turned it into line work where I could kind of figure out what I need to invent and what I can use the paintings for as reference. I'm working with a very unique canvas shape. I did an underpainting in burnt sienna on a canvas that I stretched. And my process portfolio outlines all of those steps, but I'm not talking about them in a very process-oriented way, but I will talk about them in a way that talks about the decisions that I made. Like, I chose to use a burnt sienna underpainting because it reflects the standards of the time. I also chose to do it in acrylic so it would dry faster, although my painting is going to be in oil. Once you have your drawing ready and your canvas prepped, then it's a matter of getting your drawing on the canvas. And there's so many ways that you can do this. If you are confident, you can just go right in and start sketching it out. If you don't feel super confident, you can use other methods like the grid method, which takes a little bit of math and figuring out, but it works really well. Or if you have access to an LCD projector or an old-timey overhead projector, those work great as well. All you need is your drawing and you can enlarge it. And I also only chose charcoal because I'm going to be working with some dark colored paints, and all that dust can influence the colors that you use. I'm also brushing off the excess dust from the charcoal, so it's a little bit easier for me to use, and it's gonna fade into my first layer of just using oil paint and turpentine. So I start usually with blocking in my darkest darks. And I say usually because it depends on the color underpainting that I have. If it was a really dark underpainting, then I would start with my lightest highlights. I like to start with my darkest darks because it also gives me an idea of my value scale and the range that I'm going to paint in. And although I didn't follow this with the entire painting, there's large parts of this painting that are super dark, I did follow it in the main focal area. And once I had that in, I went to block in some more mid-tones. When you're painting on a canvas that has an underpainting on it, the bright lights tend to really pop. And it's important to kind of understand that end of the value scale. Now, if I didn't do a burnt sienna underpainting on here, the lighter yellows and whites that I'm doing in the picture frame would just not have popped off of the canvas as much. Now, the whole time I'm doing this, I am keeping my sketchbook, my visual arts journal open, and I'm documenting struggles, references, and techniques that I'm using. And this is done in a very informal way, and I can make sense of it later. At this point, I'm not doing a ton of detail yet. I'm still kind of thinking in light, middle, and dark values and blocking them in. But I do start shading a tiny bit in some areas, usually if I have a little extra paint on my brush and I just need to kind of work it into an area, I might blend in a certain space. But that's the basic approach that I do for the first half of the painting, is just blocking in these areas. I'm still primarily using turpentine and oil paint only, but I'm getting ready to start with my three-part medium, which is Damar varnish, linseed oil, and turpentine. You can choose to use liquin, especially if you're in a school setting, that might work better. But you want to start building on fat over lean oil painting techniques if you're doing oil at this time. I'm not going to explain exactly how I came up with the techniques that I'm using for skin tones. I have a whole other video on that if you're interested, you can see how I work on mixing skin tones in a variety of different ranges. But for this painting, what you should know is that I approached it slightly differently because I don't generally pre-mix a lot of skin tones, but since it was a larger painting with three different portraits in there, I did mix a variety of skin tones and made sure that I included blue in there to desaturate the colors so they didn't look very synthetic. Because oil paint lasts for a long time before it dries, I was able to use this spontaneously throughout my project until I ran out of paint. I also used a disposable palette, which worked well given my situation being at school. And here are all the colors I mixed. I like to work around the portrait, and in this case, I have four portraits in here, so I'm adding the highlights to all of them at the same time. As I start blocking in a little bit more, I'm focusing on the main areas that are important. The fabric and the highlights and folds of the fabric, the drapery, and then I start going into the figures. With painting her portrait, I really was focusing on establishing the structure of her face, which I thought I could lose very easily. Her eye, I mean, obviously she has two eyes, but one is more predominantly seen in the painting, and I must have repainted and reworked that eye, I don't know, a gazillion times. And that was mainly because it's also very small in the painting. Even though it's a larger painting, her face is, you know, slightly smaller than life size. When painting fabric, it's quite formulaic, and I followed the rules of starting with the dark shadows and then the highlights, and then I blend in the midtones. And with oil paint, it kind of works out quite easily. It's smooth and blends. So right now it's my lunch break, and I'm trying to work on the portraits that are in the upper right, the Susanna and the elders, and a little bit of the one on the left of Judith in the act of slaying Holofernes. And I'm eating while I'm doing this because, you know, but I have my palette over on the side. I have my source image always available to zoom in. I like to look at it both on paper so I can look at it quickly. And I also like to look at it digitally so I can zoom in on the area that I'm focusing on. And sometimes I just need to take time to like look at everything and kind of get a feel for what I want to do before I dive in and start painting. In this case, it's helpful to do that ahead of time because, you know, I have to climb up and down on a stool to get a better look at what I'm doing. Now, the portrait of Susanna in Susanna and the Elders, which is the painting I've featured in the upper right, her skin tone is very creamy, very light. But I know that I'm going to block most of this out in the end. I'm going to do a glaze over this almost entire portrait and burnt umber glaze on top of her. And I kind of want that yellowness to stand out. There's something about working on a burnt sienna underpainting when you're doing portraits that they take this moment where they kind of look a little evil. It's probably the red in the eyes. Not so great expression. Her face is looking a little too oval, and I've lost some of that structure that I should have had. So at this point, I feel a little happier with the upper side of her face, but the lower bottom part of her face, I'm just like, no, just paint everything out. Just get rid of it all. I need to rework that. And I know that all of this is probably not going to even be visible in the final painting, but I kind of feel like I need to have the structure there, because I don't know how dark my glaze is going to go to make this painting look like it's just peeking out from the shadows. Now, I think I had the most fun painting her legs. There's these really cool shadows, and I don't know, it just felt so wonderful getting these sort of grayish skin tones on top of the burnt sienna and having that contrast on there. It was a lot of fun to do. I had been familiar with her work before I had seen it at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, but I don't know if at that point I had really seen any of her work in person. The name of the exhibition was Orazio and Artemisia Gentileschi, Father and Daughter Painters in Baroque Italy. And, you know, my life had taken a lot of turns since then. Then I was living outside New York City and visiting the Metropolitan Museum of Art all the time. And then I picked up and moved to Europe. And a country or two later, I moved to Florence, Italy, which is where Artemisia lived for a great part of her life. And I felt like I've always had this sort of connection with her work. And perhaps it's just on the baseline of just being a female artist and where we have lived. Her work has always spoken to me in a technical way and a conceptual way. And because of that, I have incorporated her work literally or more implicitly for many years. So even though this is a large painting, so much of it was just done with scumbling, with me sort of sitting on the floor or sitting low to the floor, just trying to block in color as fast as I could during my breaks and just trying to get a feel for like where things needed to be pushed back a little darker, because I wanted the bottom to look like it held space. I didn't want it to be completely like faded into the background, but I wanted these subtle hints of light and shadow. And this hint of a table, the hint of her dress and maybe an apron kind of coming down and seeing where it would go. And for that, sitting on my rolling chair really helped because I could kind of push myself around and kind of get a better feel for where everything needed to be, playing with some of the lights and colors in the shadows and whether they would go cooler or warmer and kind of pushing them back and forth. So I reworked a lot of the areas because of that. Now, I totally don't know if I really love to paint fabric or I really hate to paint fabric. I think part of me finds it very satisfying. So one of the most annoying questions I get asked all the time by students, and if you're one of my students watching this, it's true. It is one of the most annoying questions, is how long did that take you? And I know that the question comes from a good place, but mostly I don't know how long it takes me. I know when I started a piece and when I ended a piece, but I have no idea how long it takes me because I tend to work rather than saying, oh, I worked on this a half hour a day for 2 months. I worked on this for 4 hours a day for 2 months. I don't know. I work on my paintings for 10 minutes here or 8 hours. And one of the key tips that I can give you is to step away from your painting as much as possible. Look at it from far away, put it in a place where you're going to turn your head and see it in the corner, and you'll notice areas that need to be worked on. And that's what was really helpful for me, is to take time to look at it from further away and see where I needed to fix things. At this point, I'm in the final stage of painting, which has more of my three-part medium and less paint, and I'm working on blending and glazing. So I'm using very little oil paint and a lot more medium. This is perhaps my favorite part of oil painting because you can really add depth to the colors and structures and forms that you've created and alter the painting to have this depth and richness to it. The most obvious use of glazing is where I push the painting of Susanna and the Elders back into the background by using burnt umber glaze over it and the frame and the background to kind of create this chiaroscuro focused light more on her portrait. So glazing is the technique. The reason why I'm doing it is to create a more interesting composition and to follow the techniques that Artemisia Gentileschi used. And the effect is that it controls where the eye of the viewer goes around the painting. So now I'm in this state where everyone kind of thinks I'm done, but I am definitely not done. There's all these little tiny, tiny, little tiny details like the lace around her collar or whatever it is that needs to be fixed and adjusted. And I keep on messing it up, so I redo it. The shadows on her necklace. And then at one point, I just say, you know what? I'm done. Okay, I'm not going to touch it again. I am done. And I put my paintbrushes down, put it away, and I took it into a good place with nice, even lighting outside. I always like to photograph my artworks outside on a slightly overcast day. And I photographed it, and I am done. And here I have the completed painting. It will still need to be varnished, but the main idea is there. So what do you think? Now, I'm not an IB visual arts student, and I don't need to keep a process portfolio. But what I did do is make a couple sample process portfolio pages based on my visual arts journal and the ideas that I wrote down, the notes that I took in my visual arts journal. And I compiled them together in a nice, neat, organized presentation. Now, one of the reasons why you take such detailed notes and always have your journal, your sketchbook open while you're making the work is that you can just write it down at the moment, and then you can compile it to meet the visual arts criteria for the process portfolio. I have sample process portfolio pages on my website, and this, I sort of broke down the IB Art process portfolio assessment criteria into very simple, basic terms that are easy to reference. So skills, critical investigation, communication, review, refine, reflect, and your overall presentation and vocabulary. When you're first starting to put together your process portfolio, I encourage you just to dump everything in there. I call it the PP dump.
I know, childish. But that way you can always edit it down before you have to submit it and just get everything in there, and then you can refine it and make it look pretty afterwards.
At this time, go ahead and start working on your criteria F, which you will use this artwork to represent how you developed as an artist after researching your inspiration artist. Now, keep in mind, criteria F could also include other artists and other artworks, but the idea behind this video is trying to take all the work that you put into visual arts, all that hard work, and see where you can plug it into the different criteria. So take those notes from the visual arts journal and put it into a slide for criteria F that you can build on as you refine your comparative study. Linked below is my comparative study guide that gives you all the information you need to be successful in doing your CS, with lots of student examples as well. Now, speaking of students, I've included some of my students' work and their approaches that have followed this formula. A lot of my students have applied it for this really large painting portrait project. I encourage them to work constantly with their sketchbook out, doing any of their experimenting and keeping track of their process and progress throughout their art making journey. It is documented and could easily be applied to the process portfolio and or comparative study. That way, working on a really big project, time consuming project like this, they're really covering all of their bases and not wasting any time and using their time efficiently. Here's an example of a student who created their big portrait and documented the art historical research following all of the assessment criteria of the process portfolio very well and in detail, and then also used that same project as part of her comparative study and how the art historical research that she did related to the completed artwork. And these are some of her sample pages. Another student also used the large portrait with this formula, and they did a very detailed job in their process portfolio, and that actually really helped when they approached the comparative study, because a lot of the understanding of the techniques and inspiration from the art historical works were already implemented, and they were able to really translate those process portfolio slides into more of a comparative study assessment criteria. And all of these scored very well, I should say. And my last example is with not a large portrait, but with a printmaking project where the student used two different printmaking projects inspired by Kathy Kollwitz. And these are the process portfolio pages going into the comparative study. And you can see how their ideas regarding technique and composition and the ideas behind the work really overlap in some ways with the process portfolio. So these are just some strategies that I use when I teach IB Visual Arts. This way you're using your time in IB Visual Arts as efficiently as possible and addressing all of the assessment criteria that you'll be graded on. I also hope that you just understand the assessment criteria for IB Visual Arts a little bit better through this video.